Bismillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today I want us to cover poetry. To be specific, we will talk about the poem that is tested in paper 1 English, question number 3 of oral skills or functional skills, question 3 either Roman 1 or A, what you call oral poetry. But in general, I want us to discuss what a poem is all about very briefly, and then I want us to study an example of a poem and then the questions that can come in paper 1. So basically, when you talk about a poem, is an imaginative use of words in order to express thoughts and ideas that make meaning. So it has a lot of definitions, but the definition I have actually picked is, it is the art of writing thoughts, because you have to think of something, and what you thought about is what you need to put it into words. Ideas and dreams into imaginative language. Normally, a poem uses an imaginative language. It also contains a verse or a pause, a meter or a repetition. We'll be able to look at these words within the lesson as we progress. By the end of this particular lesson, I want you to define what a poem is. From there, we'll be able to look at various words that are actually used in a poem. I'm only picking the basic words, what a poet is, what a persona is. And in question number 3, oral skills, the poem that comes, what you call the oral poem, there are 4 questions that are tested. And therefore, how do you approach those 4 questions? And what are those 4 questions, and how are you able to actually tackle them in an exam? I want us to look at what you call a poem. A poem, we said, is the writing of the words in either stanza form or in a line form. So the form of writing of a poetry is different from prose. That's why we are saying that it is actually a poem as a result, or poetry is that writing that formulates a concentrated kind of an imaginative awareness of experience in form of language or in form of words. A poet is the person who writes poems. The person who writes poems, we call that particular person a poet. Persona. The persona is the voice or the person speaking in the poem. So the voice or the person speaking in the poem is what we call the persona. Then we'll be able to look at what you call stanza. When we look at stanza, this one makes up what you call a stanza. This is an example of a poem I have given to illustrate the same questions. So, but we'll be able to also use the same. So this one is a stanza. What we mean by a line is this line. A line is an equivalent of a sentence, whereas a stanza is an equivalent of a paragraph, kind of. Uh-huh. So let's move on. What are some of the questions that you will be asked in paper 1 oral skills? You will be asked 4 types of questions. Question number 1 you will be asked is about description of what you call a rhyming scheme. What is a rhyming scheme is what you'll be able to look at. Question 2, you will be asked about what you call stylistic devices or sound devices. Then question 3, they might ask you about how do you say a line in the poem. How do you say a line in the poem? Remember, this is about orality. It's an oral performance. And therefore, once orality comes into play, you have to have a speaker and an audience who have actually a very good rapport between them, because they have to interact throughout the session. And then finally, question number 4 you'll be asked is, which words will you stress in such a line, and why will you stress those particular words? So let's tackle those questions one by one. Before we read the poem, I want to describe, or I want to first of all define what a rhyming scheme is. When you talk about a rhyming scheme, a rhyming scheme is the repetition of similar sounds at the end of each word in each line. So normally, we give in form of SQ, we have similar sound syllable. So get to know, more often students have issues when it comes to rhyming scheme. A rhyming scheme is not about repetition. It's not about pronunciation of the words. It's not about the spelling of the word.
rhyming scheme is about the sound. It's about the syllable. Now, in each word that you can be able to look at it here, the end, all the last words of each line, they have either two or three, or often even one, sometimes, syllable sounds. So the sound syllable that appear at the end of each word in a line is what we call a rhyming scheme. Rhyming scheme. Yeah, so you have had similar sound syllable. You have to have those three elements. And they appear at the last word of each line in each stanza. That's what we mean by rhyming scheme. And we said that rhyming scheme is not about repetition, it's not about pronunciation, it's not about spelling, but it's about sound. It's about sound. Fine. Now, having looked at what a rhyming scheme is all about, question number one, let's look at this particular poem. We read the poem, and then from there we'll be able to actually understand how to tackle this question of describe the rhyming scheme of this particular poem. Let's go through the poem together. Make me a grave wherever you will, in a lowly plain or a lofty hill. Make it among earth's humblest graves, but not in a land where men are slaves. I could not, if around my grave I heard the steps of a trembling slave. His shadow above my silent tomb would make it a place of fearful gloom. I could not rest if I heard the tread of a coffin going to the shambles' lair, and the mother's shriek of wild despair rise like a curse on the trembling air. This poem was written by Frances Ellen Waxman Harper. Now, how do you describe this rhyming scheme? How do you answer this question? By answering this question, you need to actually analyze the rhyming scheme on the question paper itself, on the poem itself. So let's go through. Normally we ascribe alphabetical letters in smaller letters to actually attach each word starting from the first line up to the last line. So for instance, the first word we'll be able to look at here is the words that we'll consider. These are the words we'll consider. Will, heal, graves, slaves, grave, slave, tomb, gloom, then tread, lead, despair, and air. Those are the last words we'll be able to actually look at. How did we define a rhyming scheme? We said these are similar sound syllables that appear at the end of each line in the last word, the sound syllable in the last word. So let's move together. Will, we ascribe the first letter A in small letter. Will, we ascribe this one as A. Heal, the sound that you have is, this one starts with wa, this one starts with ha. It's different. We are not looking at the first sound syllable of the last word. Rather, we are looking at the last sound syllable of the word itself. So, will, A, heal, ill, ill. They are actually pronounced the same way. So we have ascribed A, because they are similar. Let's go to the third line. We have graves. Because it is not similar to this, we ascribe to the next letter. B, graves. This is slaves. The sound that we have is here. So this one is also pronounced the same way as that one. It rhymes with graves. Let's go to stanza number two. Grave is different from graves. Look at this. This is graves. The last sound you have is sound. Then this one is slaves. That's why they are rhyming together. But when you come to stanza three, line one and line two, they are different. You have ev sound. So you have grave. This one cannot rhyme with this. Therefore, we ascribe this to C. This one is also C because they rhyme together. You have grave and then slave. Let's move to the second line, third line rather. This is tomb, tomb, tomb. So the B at the end is silent. And therefore, you have tomb. This one is not rhyming with any of the above. And therefore, we go to the next letter. You have D, gloom, That's what you have. Then you ascribe. You have D, D. And then you have thread, lead, ed, ed is what you have. D, next you go to E, E. Because these two also rhyme together. Then you have wild, despair. We are looking at only the word despair, the last word. Uh-huh. So despair, air, is the last word we have. So this one is F, then air, F. That's what we have. Now, that's the first step. Now, coming to the question on the answer, you write the way it is, without putting commas or separating in form of stanzas. You just write the way they are. So, your question answer to the question is A, B, B, C, C, D, D, E, E, F, 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 F. Remember, rhyming scheme is classified into two. We have a regular rhyming scheme and irregular rhyming scheme. Now, a regular rhyming scheme is a rhyming scheme whose pattern can be able to be predicted in the next line or the next stanza, because you have a follow-up or sequential order of the alphabetical letters and the rhyming words. Like in our case, this is a regular rhyming scheme. Why? Because you have AA, BB, CC, DD, EE, FF. If we were to guess the next line, if perhaps the poem will have continued and we were to guess the next line, then it will be GG, then HH, like that. So if you are able to predict the pattern of the rhyming scheme, then that one is regular rhyming scheme. Regular rhyming scheme. So we say the poem has regular rhyming scheme. So this is identification for 1 mark, and then telling us saying whether it is a regular or irregular rhyming scheme also earns you another mark. Now, question number two. Apart from rhyme, mention two other ways rhythm has been achieved in the poem. What is rhythm? There's a difference between rhythm and rhyme. We've already looked at rhyme. Rhythm is the regular beat or the sound to which the dancers can be able to move to in a musical instrument, or when the poem is being sung or it is being performed in front of an audience. So how do you achieve rhythm? Often these are sound devices. They are sound devices. So they are stylistic devices in the poem that can be able to actually help us achieve the rhythm of the poem. Hiya. Let's move on. Number one, that can be able to help us achieve, that is question number two, let's put it Roman one, is repetition. Repetition. Repetition is used to achieve the rhythm of the poem, because repetition often brings emphasis. Uh-huh. So repetition. What is repeated here is, you look at words that are repeated. You have words like could not, one is there. Could not, those words are repeated. The word make is also repeated. So you have to have the identification, repetition one, but you have to illustrate from the poem. So what the words that are repeated are make, comma, then could not. So these words are repeated. By the repetition of these particular words, they'll bring that uniformity of the rhythm of the poem. Another thing that brings the rhythm or achieves or helps us achieve the rhythm of the poem is what we call alliteration. 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 When you talk about alliteration, is the repetition of similar consonant sounds at the beginning of words in a line in close proximity. So the words have to appear within the same line. They have to begin with same consonant sounds within the same line, but in close range. That's what we mean by alliteration. An example here, for instance, look at line one, make me a grave. So if you have make me a grave, you have make me starts with M, me, make me, make me. Maybe that's the one that is standing out for now. Make me. That is also that. That's an alliteration. So you have make me. So you have to underline MM. And then you can say sound M alliterates. Yeah, alliterates. It's the sound that you'll alliterate here. So by identifying 1 mark, by illustrating from the poem, another mark. So we can go on and on. This was only 4 marks, you have to identify only two, but let's move on. Let's move on. For instance, do we have an assonance in this poem? Assonance in this poem? Yes. Yeah, assonance also helps us achieve the rhythm of a poem. Assonance is the the repetition of similar vowel sounds. This is an opposite, vowel sounds. For instance, I want you to look at the last line in the last stanza. Rise, like. So you have rise, then like. Uh-huh. So sound I there, E, what we call E, yeah. Like, rise, like, I. That sound is a sonetic. Is a sonetic. We also can be able to get what you call consonants. Consonants, do we have one? Yes, consonants, Roman 4. Consonants seems to be a bit similar to alliteration, but there is a difference. This is the repetition of similar consonant sounds, but this happens at the end of the word. Whereas alliteration was actually, the word was appearing at the beginning the sound or the letter, the consonant sound was appearing at the beginning of the word. In consonants, it appears at the end of, it appears at the end of the word. For instance, if you have a word like, line, make note, here shadow, could not. Yes, if you have a word like not rest, yeah, not, sorry, but not, yeah, but not. This is the word, but not, yeah. So you have but not. So this T, yeah, it appears at the end of the word. So in case you are given this about functional writing, sorry, about stylistic devices, then you need to identify the stylistic device. Then you have to illustrate from the poem for you to earn a marks. Remember, there is no illustration or there is no identification without either. There is no identification without illustration, and there should not be illustration without an identification, though they have to go together. Then question number three is about how will you say the last line. If you are asked about this question, how will you say about the last line, two things will come into the mind. One is about intonation. How will you say? Because this is performance, it's about orality. So you should consider yourself as you are on stage and you are performing this to an audience. So how will you say? Intonation, whether you should say it in a rising tone or a falling tone. The other thing that comes is by use of what you call nonverbal cues. Use of nonverbal cues, either by show of your hand or show of using of nonverbal cues, like expressions, like, so that you can be able to actually say it and the audience can be able to understand you very well. So the last line we have is rise like a curse on the trembling air. This is a sentence like. So all sentences or normal sentences have falling intonation. So question three, you say, I'll say it with a falling intonation. And because it is rise like a curse on the trembling air, by the time you are saying rise, you can be able to actually put your finger up to indicate something that is rising. That's the nonverbal cues that we are talking about. Then which words will you stress? Yes. And why? Perhaps line one, make me a grave wherever you will. Once you are told which words will you stress, the words that you should be able to stress should be the words that are able to indicate to you that they carry or they are the content words in that particular line. For instance, in this line one, we can stress, make me grave wherever you will. We can stress those three words. So the answer to that is, You have told us which words you will stress. So the answer, the other question will be, why do you want to stress those particular words? You want to stress those words because they are the content words. In other words, they carry the meaning of the meaning of the poem. Now, having said that, these questions about rhyming scheme, about rhythm, you need to understand and get to know the difference between these stylistic devices. such that if it's alliteration, you're not supposed to be telling us or giving us the definition of alliteration. But what you need to do is just identify from the poem, and after you have identified from the poem, then what you need to do is get the illustration from the poem. Like the way we have here, alliteration, make me. These two MM is the one that is alliterating. The M sound is the one that alliterates. So next lesson, inshallah, we'll be able to pick different types of poems. Get to know one thing, that if you're given a poem, poems have different classes or they have different types. Maybe the next lesson we'll be able to talk about various forms of a poem and how to tackle poem questions. But for now, what we have just discovered is just a brief introduction of what a poetry is all about. But what we are covering really is not the literary poem of question 3 in paper 2. What we are covering now is question 3 of paper 1, what we call the oral poem. And basically, these are the four things that can be asked. Although this question can also be twisted in a different form. So with those very few remarks, I wish to pause the lesson here. We talked about poetry, and we said a basic definition we can give now is the art of writing thoughts or ideas or even dreams into an imaginative language, which may contain either a verse, a pause or a meter, or even a repetition. It also means a writing that formulates a concentrated imaginative awareness of experience in language. We talked about a poet, and we said a poet is the person who writes poems. It's the author or the writer of the poem. Then the persona, we said, is the voice or the person speaking in the poem. Perhaps in the next lesson, we'll be able to pick a poem to illustrate who the person of the poem is. And then we talked about a paper one. To be specific, paper 1, that is 101/1, question number 3 on oral skills, either A or B. If oral narrative is missing, the question that you have is always oral poetry. So oral poetry that comes in, it's always between 4 to 8 marks often, sometimes. Yeah, it does not have a lot of marks. So, but this is a lot, considering that particular paper being 60%. Yeah, this is a lot. So this one, we said there are four questions that you will be asked. One is about the rhyming scheme of the poem. Two is about the stylistic devices. Three is about how would you say that line in that stanza. And three is about how do you say those, which words will you stress in that line or in that particular stanza and why. For rhyming scheme, we talked about it, and we said rhyming scheme is the similar sound syllables that appear at the end of the words in each line, and therefore they have to be the last sound syllable. Remember what we said, it's the last sound syllable. I also tried to emphasize this, and I said that a rhyming scheme is not about repetition. It's not about pronunciation. It's not about spelling. Yeah. So it's about sound syllables, the last sound syllable. Mm-hmm. And then we said we also use the alphabetical letters to ascribe the words. So we also said that rhyming scheme, they are of two types. We have the regular rhyming scheme. These are rhyming schemes whose regular pattern can be able to be predicted, and they're in sequential order. So you can be able to predict in the next line. And then finally, we said the words where you would ask how will you say that line how will you say that line in the poem is about performance. We said that you need to think about the intonation that you will be able to use to say that particular line. And you should also be able to tell us, is there any nonverbal cue that you can be able to use so that you can be able to put across that particular line to the audience? So on about the last question that was asking about which words will you stress, you need to identify the major words or the words that carry the meaning of the poem, the meaning of that particular line. Those are the major words. And then from there, you'll be able to say that you'll have picked those particular words or you have stressed them because they carry the meaning of the poem or the meaning of that particular line. So with those very few remarks, I wish to stop the lesson there, and I wish you all the best. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for listening.